She left her little room and made her way through the shadows of the main attic, bumping against the ping-pong table. Now I'll have a bruise on my hip on top of everything else, she thought. Next, she walked into her old doll's house, Charles Wallace's rocking horse, the twins' electric trains. Why must everything happen to me? She demanded of a large teddy bear. At the foot of the attic stairs, she stood still and listened. Not a sound from Charles Wallace's room on the right. On the left, in her parents' room, not a rustle from her mother sleeping alone in the great double bed. She tiptoed down the hall and into the twins' room, pushing again at her glasses as though they could help her to see better in the dark. Dennis was snoring. Sandy murmured something about baseball and subsided. The twins didn't have any problems. They weren't great students, but they weren't bad ones either. They were perfectly content with a succession of B's and an occasional A or C. They were strong and fast runners and good at games, and when cracks were made about anybody in the Murray family, they weren't made about Sandy and Dennis. She left the twins' room and went on downstairs, avoiding the creaking seventh step. Fortinbras had stopped barking. It wasn't the tramp this time, then. Fort would go on barking if anybody was around. But suppose the tramp does come? Suppose he has a knife? Nobody lives near enough to hear if we screamed and screamed and screamed. Nobody'd care, anyhow. I'll make myself some cocoa, she decided. That'll cheer me up. And if the roof blows off, at least I won't go off with it. In the kitchen, a light was already on, and Charles Wallace was sitting at the table drinking milk and eating bread and jam. He looked very small and vulnerable sitting there alone in the big old-fashioned kitchen, a blonde little boy in faded blue Dr. Denton's, his feet swinging a good 6 inches above the floor. Hi, he said cheerfully. I've been waiting for you. From under the table where he was lying at Charles Wallace's feet, hoping for a crumb or two, Fortinbras raised his slender dark head in greeting to Meg, and his tail thumped against the floor. Fortinbras had arrived on their doorstep, a half-grown puppy, scrawny and abandoned, one winter night. He was, Meg's father had decided, part Llewellyn Setter and part greyhound, and he had a slender, dark beauty that was all his own. "Why didn't you come up to the attic?" Meg asked her brother, speaking as though he were at least her own age. "I've been scared stiff." "Too windy up in that attic of yours," the little boy said. "I knew you'd be down. I put some milk on the stove for you. It ought to be hot by now." How did Charles Wallace always know about her? How could he always tell? He never knew, or seemed to care, what Dennis or Sandy were thinking. It was his mother's mind, and Meg's, that he probed with frightening accuracy. Was it because people were a little afraid of him that they whispered about the Murray's youngest child, who was rumored to be not quite bright? "I've heard that clever people often have subnormal children," Meg had once overheard. "The two boys seem to be nice, regular children, but that unattractive girl and the baby boy certainly aren't all there." It was true that Charles Wallace seldom spoke when anybody was around, so that many people thought he'd never learn to talk, and it was true that he hadn't talked at all until he was almost four. Meg would turn white with fury when people looked at him and clucked, shaking their heads sadly. "Don't worry about Charles Wallace, Meg," her father had once told her. Meg remembered it very clearly because it was shortly before he went away. "There's nothing the matter with his mind. He just does things in his own way and in his own time." "I don't want him to grow up to be dumb like me," Meg had said. "Oh, my darling, you're not dumb," her father answered. "You're like Charles Wallace. Your development has to go at its own pace. It just doesn't happen to be the usual pace." "How do you know?" Meg had demanded. "How do you know I'm not dumb? Isn't it just because you love me?"
"I love you, but that's not what tells me. Mother and I have given you a number of tests, you know."
Yes, that was true. Meg had realized that some of the games her parents played with her were tests of some kind, and that there had been more for her and Charles Wallace than for the twins.
IQ tests, you mean?
Yes, some of them.
Is my IQ okay?